Welcome to the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award Ceremony, once again presented online. We thank you for taking the time to join us in celebrating the 6 award winners and helping us raise awareness about their courage, persistence, and resilience. In our troubled world, human rights defenders, and especially those we honour this year, stand out for their clarity of purpose, determination of cause, and commitment to community, humanity, and planet. Frontline Defenders has now been working for 20 years to provide human rights defenders with the practical resources and support they need for their security and protection. During that time, we have grown as an organization to meet increased demand from more defenders in more spaces and places. How we understand security and protection has developed and become more holistic. New challenges have arisen, and these last 2 years of pandemic have pushed the human rights community to new depths of solidarity and forced us to question how we can improve our support to defenders. Today, we gather to celebrate those who face down risks, threats, and danger in order to make a better world for all of us. From accompanying children to school, to standing up to a multinational company to protect rural livelihoods, and from exposing corruption, devastating the natural world, to struggling to overturn centuries of racism, the human rights defenders you will meet show us another world is possible. I am proud to present the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award to human rights defenders from Belarus, Brazil, Cambodia, Palestine, Portugal, and Sierra Leone. Each has faced repression, threat and attack because they work to defend and advance the human rights of their communities. Yet each offers hope and works from a place of love. I want to thank the patrons of the 2021 award, Irish parliamentarians, Jennifer Carroll McNeill TD, Sean Crow TD, Cormac Devlin TD, Ivana Bacik TD, Gary Gannon TD, and Senator Roisin Garvey, who you will meet as they present each regional winner. Finally, I thank you to the staff of Frontline Defenders who continue to do all they can to support human rights defenders in the face of challenges ranging from the pandemic to evacuating human rights defenders from Afghanistan and supporting Palestinian defenders with hacked phones and everything in between. Once again, thank you for joining us in recognising the uncommon bravery of the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award winners. Please share this video and the information about these human rights defenders. By spreading this awareness, we expand our community, support for human rights defenders, and push forward towards justice.
On behalf of the Board of Directors, it is my honour to welcome you to the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award for Human Rights Defenders at Risk. As you will soon come to learn, this year's award winners demonstrate incredible courage and determination in defending the rights of their communities, protecting the environment, and advancing the cause of justice. Belarus to Palestine, Sierra Leone to Brazil and Portugal, to Cambodia. The human rights defenders you will meet during the ceremony are risking arrest, physical attacks, imprisonment, and even worse. As the COVID pandemic continues to reshape and impact our lives, we pause to recognize and honor these human rights defenders who adapted to the new realities but have persisted in their struggles for their communities and the planet. I thank our generous and reliable donors and supporters, especially for their ongoing support during the pandemic, as we continue to meet human rights defenders' increasing need for security in more complex ways. Frontline defenders' ability to respond quickly and effectively is very much a result of the effective partnerships we've developed with our supporters. This year marked the 20th anniversary of Frontline Defenders. While we did not feel it was appropriate to celebrate, as we could not bring people safely together, we do take this moment to reflect on 2 decades of working to ensure the protection and security of human rights defenders around the world. Frontline Defenders staff work tirelessly to ensure human rights defenders have the resources and capacity to address their security needs so that they may do their work effectively. The six human rights defenders we are celebrating today demonstrate day in and day out why our mission is so critical. Once again, on behalf of the Frontline Defenders Board of Directors and the entire organization, thank you for joining us for this unique celebration of the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award winners, and congratulations to these human rights defenders.
Rights defenders on the front lines defending their communities face a myriad of challenges around the world. I'm Jennifer Carroll McNeill, a member of the Irish Parliament, and I am proud to present Aminata Faba from Sierra Leone as the Africa Regional winner of the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award. Aminata is from a small area called Malin, which is the focus of land acquisition and palm oil exploitation by a multinational company. When she, along with other small landowners in her community, were threatened with losing their land to be given to the company and without redress from the government, Aminata stood up for her and her community's rights, leading protests and challenging the company, the government and traditional authorities. For this, Aminata has been detained, received threats and is under intense pressure to give up her struggle. I am honoured to present Aminata and send her power and solidarity.
Nay, poetry are near that my family. Colorable advantage, junior, Montu, Molero, suffering agricultural community winner, Molorment are coming in. Jehunati Aka Nyaga, Data, I tell me, honorable Shaka Samaya will tell honorable a PMO organization, but a matter of Marua, Nana or Muvani.
Aminata is a great lady. She is one of the strongest women that we have in Malwa, the Malian Affected Land Owners Association. She is the deputy women's leader, and she has been very instrumental in mobilizing the other women to advocate for their rights.
Jinati do gbo mu mu ya ti mi le ma gbe lui na gbe ago ma ku mi si a ko nya ga Jinati do gbo mu mu ya Timelima Billy. Yet, dog would you Google Donabo Gamale Gala or Queenie Sabre or Cunha that I am a clinic to you, Bobby, Matunu Martin, Yatia, Tato Home, Tediati said you. So Naman, I am Munyagabe, Kagia Namale, Nya Lidega Matata Hanadin. Gay Jitty Siama, Munyaga Muhija Malo, a weapon of aggression. Nagia Goma. Eyi lo munyaga moyele ma kujo komu demonstration Women's Day so moyele ma komu munyaga pe komu le aba mu ma TV chatter ke before na yema mo do ma write lo mo di o writing mo civil society na tin amoto writing mo police se eni o sin writing nya vimia good year you quit a perma to write him up or sink a tidy matter die same meeting on. So we are na vi room on him a colour na to see my mood room, Tama said to him. Siamamu yale mamufu ibenga junction. Kemo loa maeta ke kopwe ya pujom. Polisi gama, LUC, ye owa amu stopi. Be ye seto kwe na petu go me ma daise minti na moya ana. Timo aseti ya, namu mara mungu gya, tawo lo ma. Ke se polisi se ato wa troki, timo stopi ibenga junction.
I'm not a... and the rest of the women struggling for land issues in the chiefdom of Malin. Their struggle is deep-seated in the area of rights over landed property, rights over tenureship of land, which is an issue in current day Sierra Leone. Their struggle is out of the deep desire to keep living on a land that has been taken away from them by the government, the company, and the chiefdom authorities.
Then na manya de go enna le go mo jona di sisariga kati ya ma pujo mwe ne moli ena na mo ya ma mutu rika ti mu stop ya say e police ji atebi mwe amuna we na ma ti mu aksimara mutu litua titi snapi ti mu interview ti no grand grand interview to call ona gbo ya go up ya mutu rika ka jona di sisato wana. Muya, tamu ala ala mujoko. Mujoko ale mumu bane mvumbu. So mudi yona, tamu ala ala kamwe mujoko. Ye temi na mena, tuwe tinya ho. Tuwe atrupilo, katuwa, tete ya mahelo nyarima. Yegi ya tewe, tuwa abuhu uma. So siya na tinya hui, mande nyagago, ye diwi minatanya je hui na. Gale vitape isi, ye diwi nemea weya himbegu mao, ta ahayamu. Lewe ye jita, nye ge ya widro. So ti di age sell you te go widro go gwa malu age ge gwa malu hara na wa age bi fa kele wu hu bi age gbe ba mamia bi ye na gala do me cement ya sell you.
Aminata a de vet like man e even get the zeal pass some of money among we.
Ye pati na me nyage na se na tinya ho tebo ko esani le do bo de na va gege pi to nyaje gadaji na ge nyama mata me o tama ye do bo license ge ya so mo block yo mo lu mi se do bo ge ke na ri o sebe na ta hello nyava.
I see Aminata struggle not only from the perspective of rights issue, but there are also deeper policy and legal issues. We have laws that are supposed to be giving women the level of empowerment that they deserve to grow, but those laws are not implemented, or they are shrouded in customary and traditional practices to the extent that you know, women's role is minuscule.
We have a lot of people that are afraid to speak up for fear of being arrested. Another one of those women has been very strong, that has been able to speak up, and that she has been able to mobilize a lot of women to give them the zeal to join in the advocacy. So I'm not as a role model.
Amo eji tamunya aga be se na mo ji amuru amumu right igoga. Mi agbele nu mo agwa wo na mo wo ma na mo right iva.
I'm not does not think that she's a woman, that she should be at the back. Sometimes you have amateur women on motorbikes visiting communities, talking to men and women when we have programs, encourage them to attend the programs. When there are protests, peaceful protests, amateur will be in the forefront, leading, inspiring other members to join in. She has received a lot of threats. She has been arrested, but she has not quitted.
So Aminata, her struggle to be lifted out of that position is something that we need to support. And I think government need to recognize not only her, but all of those women who are struggling for one, better life, but also for rights as a woman or as a gender, but at the same time for opportunities, because these are things that they are struggling for out there. When land is taken away, you lose everything.
Goye dita owa nyaga ma akiage kenyage ge epeye ma viwo nya baga vadwel because no aga hela ye peye ma te ma lo mi ma te dibo da vinya we ke te ato ma kenya to nya gbambe ma gala pi na hin ko nu ga te la ejo daya eje ji vi go go ma ha ye vi ma ma fanya na so ke go nya ma ko ne.
Hello, my name is Ivana Bacik and I am a member of the Irish Parliament who has worked for many years for women's rights. I am proud to introduce America's regional winner of the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award, Camila Maradia from Complex Alameo in Brazil. Camila Maradia is a black woman human rights defender, a mother and leader of the housing movement in the Alameo complex, the largest favela complex in Rio de Janeiro. She is also one of the coordinators of Women in Action, a collective dedicated to ending gender-based violence and to empowering women. Camila works in a context of permanent police violence, racism, and stigmatization. In 2015, Camila established the collective Women in Action in Alameo. Her mission is to end violence against women and to contribute to the empowerment of women and their families, thus strengthening their autonomy and guaranteeing their basic human rights. I salute Camila and I send her strength and solidarity.
Camila Santos é uma mulher preta, favelada, mãe de três crianças negras, uma mulher forte, mas também é uma mulher fraca. E justamente a sua fraqueza que é a sua maior força.
É uma mulher preta muito determinada, que é um alcance fora do normal e às vezes acha que não consegue, né? Às vezes ela mesmo se diminui por achar que ela não consegue e quando ela vai ver ela já está lá na frente, já avançou.
Ela faz um papel muito importante na minha vida, que é de me inspirar, de ser alguém que me incentiva a ser uma pessoa melhor.
Camila Santos é a luta. Me entendo como defensora de direitos humanos desde o dia 25 de maio de 2015. Houve uma audiência pública aqui no Complexo do Alemão e durante a semana dessa audiência pública, por conta da luta por moradia, né, a gente já estava há 5 anos no aluguel social, a formação, né, os preparativos para essa audiência pública, eu mobilizei todas as famílias do aluguel social para participar de uma audiência pública que era para falar de segurança, mas onde teríamos autoridade, né, o poder público estaria presente, e aí eu consegui mobilizar essas famílias para participarem da audiência e lá a gente começou a cobrar os nossos direitos relacionados à questão habitacional. Então, eu me enxergo desse dia em diante, oficialmente. Eu nasci na Grota e a memória que eu tenho, assim, da minha mãe lutando, brigando. Eu estudei num local que hoje é uma igreja, dentro, né, da Grota. E aí tinha aquele leite de saquinho e o leite não chegou, foi desviado. E eu me lembro da minha mãe conversando e articulando com outras mulheres. Então, isso já está presente desde esse dia, né? Eu tinha acho que uns 5, 6 anos. A questão da violência contra a mulher está muito relacionado ao que eu sou, ao processo que eu venho sofrendo, né? Por me colocar num lugar de luta, à frente de uma luta. E aí essas demandas começam a chegar de questão de violência contra a mulher e todos os tipos de violência contra a mulher. E nesse momento eu entendo que é importante e necessário fazer algo. Eu costumo falar que tudo que eu vi era muito padrão, né? Como enfrentar a violência doméstica ou a violência contra a mulher era tudo muito padrão, sendo que a nossa realidade é outra. E para dentro das favelas e para as mulheres pretas e faveladas é ainda pior. E aí a gente começou a criar caminhos adaptados, medidas adaptadas para a nossa realidade de verdade. Não é fácil uma mulher favelada sofrer violência doméstica, por exemplo, e liga para o 190, vai ligar para a polícia. Então a gente tinha que ter outros caminhos.
Isso é um ponto muito, muito tenso, né? Porque às vezes a gente tem uma rede de apoio, querendo ou não, né? A gente tem uma rede de apoio. E algumas manas não têm essa rede. E aí tem as crianças em casa e a violência é muito dolorosa. De alguma forma ela é dolorosa. Doméstica ela parece ser pior, porque você está com uma pessoa que você confiava que ia te fazer bem. E aí eu e Camila tem conversado bastante sobre isso, de como captar algo para essas mulheres, como ter uma rede que a gente consiga apoiar uma mulher por um tempo, ela sair daquele espaço de casa, sair daquele quadrado que é violento.
Essas mães, elas só estão esperando chegar, entendeu? E quando elas veem que dá para elas fazerem, correr atrás com as mãos delas, no caso dos cursos que a gente oferece de culinária, biscuit, elas veem que dá para elas captarem um dinheirinho delas com o esforço delas. Eu acho que é muito legal quando elas conseguem, falam assim, aí elas ligam, falam, olha, eu consegui vender tanto, eu consegui fazer o bolo, eu consegui fazer o sacolé, olha, esse mês eu não vou precisar de ajuda, porque eu já estou conseguindo sozinha. Mas isso é muito legal.
Eu acho que o exemplo da Camila, o exemplo de tanta gente que luta nas favelas do Rio de Janeiro e do Brasil, né, esse ímpeto, essa iniciativa ativa, forte e destemida de fazer o mundo de novo. Você nasce, cresce, trabalha e vive cercada de injustiça, cercada de absurdos, cercada de coisas que não deviam acontecer. Então, o que é que a gente precisa? Fazer tudo de novo. É romper com tudo. Existe muita coisa errada. É claro que você vai elencando, né? A iniciativa da Camila, por exemplo, é romper com as forças da morte, que produzem morte, produzem desterritorialização, ou seja, perde casa, perde comida, enfrenta a violência todo dia. É romper com isso, não aceitar essa narrativa. Isso é mais do que uma narrativa, né? Isso é uma marca, uma força concreta que esmaga você, se você não tiver quem lhe ampare, quem lhe ajude, né? Esse é o lugar do ativismo.
A gente sabe que tudo que é feito é um plano mesmo na sociedade para que mulheres pretas, de fato, não se enxerguem dessa forma. Então, para mim, o prêmio maior que eu estou tendo é eu mesma, com esse prêmio, conseguir reconhecer a minha capacidade, conseguir entender que, de fato, eu sou quem eu sou e o que eu estou fazendo, realmente sou eu que estou fazendo e o quanto isso é importante.
Esse plantio dela não está sendo em vão, por mais que ela não veja hoje. Uma hora ela vai ver e está florescendo. E dizer para ela que, por muitas das vezes, ela pensa que ela não é alguém importante, mas ela é.
Houve sempre mulheres negras que lutaram por um lugar melhor. E você é uma delas. Honra essa herança. Eu quero te dar os parabéns porque você também é um elo nessa corrente que vai deixar uma herança. Né? Vai deixar uma herança de que favela precisa ser um lugar de justiça. Que favela precisa ser um lugar de vida. E que a vida e a justiça da favela se faz por mãos de mulheres negras. E eu quero dizer também da minha alegria de você ser uma irmã. Né? Uma irmã junto com tantas de nós na luta.
Mulher, o mundo é nosso. Tu merece. Merece pra caralho, que tu é brava.
Meu maior sonho de vida pessoal é poder contribuir com a democracia, contribuir com o povo, estar sempre disponível para que a gente possa conquistar nossos objetivos.
It's with great joy I celebrate this award for you, Camila. In a country and a continent marked by racism and violence against human rights defenders of Black people's rights, to celebrate the life and the story of Camila is an important recognition of the historical and ancestral struggles for racial justice in Latin America. These human rights defenders, especially Black women activists such as Camila, are fighting for a new world where people can live, be free, have autonomy, and an equal space in society. This struggle also happens at community level, where Black women defenders are facing daily risks to fight against gender-based violence, to build support networks for women in vulnerable situations, and to strengthen collective resistance in a context marked by violence of the police and non-state actors. Frontline Defenders has been supporting protection strategies of Black women defenders all over the region facing risks, harassment, defamation, cyber attacks, smear campaigns, and even death threats due to their activism. It's an honor for us to celebrate the life and the struggle of Camila and so many other women activists in Complexo do Limão, in other favelas of Brazil, and in so many other communities in the region. Using the words of the Black activist and philosopher Angela Davis, when the Black woman moves, the whole structure of society moves with her.
Protecting the environment has been at the core of my work for years and is a special focus for me as an Irish senator. My name is Roisin Garvey and I am honoured to announce Mother Nature Cambodia as the Asia Pacific regional winner of the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award. What started as a small campaign to empower Indigenous communities to mobilise against a hydroelectric dam developed into a large movement of human rights defenders, the vast majority young university students, campaigning to protect the environment and expose corruption in Cambodia. Now, the government there has gone all out against the organisation, deregistering it and arresting many of its activists. Due to the threats against the members, we are unable to profile any of the Cambodian activists inside the country, while others who are outside fear for retribution against their families. Nonetheless, Mother Nature Cambodia continues its campaigning work online and continues to expose the intentional and corrupt degradation of the land and natural environment in Cambodia by those in power.
We got started in 2013, actually late 2012, and then officially 2013, because we realized how things were not really working in terms of environmental protection in Cambodia. You know, there was huge deforestation, there was a lot of sand mining going on, there was a lot of illegal gold mining, indigenous people were losing their land. So we thought, this is clearly not working, let's do our own stuff, you know, and it will be Cambodians doing it, it will be grassroots based, it will not be based on large donors, it will be based on mostly Cambodian people giving us small donations. Yeah, that's how we got started. And it was actually, at first it was a campaign to stop a devastating hydroelectric dam, which was not about electricity, it was about logging and corruption. And as a result of that, we were actually quite successful. We managed to stop the construction of this fake hydro dam. I got myself deported out of Cambodia after 12 years, unfortunately. But the rest of the team, you know, all Cambodians, they remained in the country and we started doing other campaigns. So yeah, that was the birth of Mother Nature Cambodia. Basically, the reason we started using our own social media tools, Facebook, YouTube, is because it was actually very little of independent media in the country, and the very few independent media outlets out there were not able or willing to go to the remote areas we were working in. So we thought, well, hang on, we have to present a campaign to people, we have to get our message across, we have to highlight the impacts of these fake development projects. And the only way we can do that is through our own means. And that literally meant our own little cameras or mobile phones, sometimes not even a microphone. And, you know, we ourselves being the people in the video, doing the script writing, the production, the editing, the filming, and then, of course, the releasing the videos ourselves. And then as a result of that, there was a lot of media outlets that would pick up our videos and then start doing stories about the campaigns we were running. And it has been very effective. We've had over 30 million views just in our Facebook page since 2015 alone. Hundreds of thousands of shares in total. As I said, local and international media have picked up our videos. Our videos are usually very short, they're like from 2 to 3 minutes. There's always Cambodian activists in the videos. We always try and put some English subtitles below. And we basically frame the videos in a way that we don't really accuse the government of anything. We basically ask questions to the relevant ministers, and you know, we, as Cambodian citizens, demand an answer from them. And it's always about systematic, wide-scale, serious destruction of the environment or human rights abuses or corruption related to natural resources of the country. And the only reason you're seeing me here and not a Cambodian is because Cambodian activists, we've got 6 of our activists in jail, so obviously they can't be in the video, and the rest of our team is cannot afford to be in a video because they will be arrested and jailed automatically afterwards. We have been repressed severely over the last 6-7 years. So unfortunately, it is me who has to be in this video. But hopefully the true heroes, the men and women who are doing our videos, they'll be able to pick up the prize in the not so distant future.
We were motivated to get involved with Man and Nature Cambodia because we love justice, nature, and we want to see Cambodia to be developed in a sustainable way. And the reason that we choose Man and Nature Cambodia because we were inspired by the bravery and effectiveness of the previous environmental activists.
Environmental activists or human rights activists in Cambodia, as well as independent media, as well as members of the opposition party, they've been repressed. They are repressed systematically, and it's more often than not state-sponsored repression, which means being followed around by people, police, army, being verbally threatened publicly or at village level, or in far too many cases being jailed. And so far from 2015 until now, we've had 12 of our activists have been jailed.
And about the repression we faced, that we were threatened by the government to stop doing our campaign. We were put to jail for up to 14 months, and now we are being put under court supervision for an irrational allegation of treason. Our parents were also being threatened, so now they keep pressuring us to stop doing what we do.
Unfortunately, our Cambodian activists could no longer appear on videos. They have to distort their voices, their faces. That never was the case up until a year ago. Unfortunately, that has to happen now. And even after doing that, they still are at considerable risk. Thankfully, there's been no physical violence against us, as in extrajudicial killings or extrajudicial, people being beaten up. But of course, being sent to jail arbitrarily without a crime being committed, you can argue is a form of violence by the state. Despite this state-sponsored, relentless campaign of repression against the effective work that our young activists do, it never ceases to amaze me how there's no shortage of Cambodians who want to continue exposing environmental destruction with the hope that the level of destruction will slow down. Every time there is harassment, unfortunately judicial harassment, in most cases jail, against our activists, the short-term impacts are civil society, Cambodians in general, especially young Cambodians, active young Cambodians, they get really scared. They think it could happen to them too. And there's kind of like a tendency to step back for a while, but eventually, they go back to their campaigning and even more inspired than before, I guess. So I think the impact of all this repression against us has been, on the short term, it scares people. But on the long term, I think it is creating this new, you know, this wave of environmental activism, you know, direct, peaceful environmental activism, which to most Cambodians, they realize that, unfortunately, that's the only thing it works. You know, when you have, you don't have a independent judiciary, you don't have checks and balances, you have a very repressive dictatorial regime, then you have to take direct, peaceful action yourself to protect the environment.
We want our fellow citizens to know that protecting our environment is not a crime. It is an obligation for the sake of the future generation. Be strong for Cambodia.
To us, winning this award is a very big motivation for us from Frontline Defender and people all around the world to continue to work while being persecuted by the court. It is a testimony to show that protecting the environment is not a crime, but it's something that is being valued by wonderful people who love the planet. The recognition encourages people and activists in Cambodia as well as in other countries, especially those who are living in the dictatorship regime, to stand up for the environment.
As an Irish Member of Parliament, I'm constantly working here on issues of fairness and equality. My name is Sean Crowe and I'm proud to introduce one of the two 2021 Frontline Defender Award winners for Europe and Central Asia. Mamadou Ba from Portugal. Born in Senegal and an immigrant to Portugal, Mamadou Ba has dedicated his life to anti-racism activism. He's been a member of the SOS Racismo movement since 1999 and is a founding member of several national and European organisations defending the rights of migrants and racialised people. Mamadou is one of the most prominent voices of the anti-racist movement in Portugal and who has denounced the proliferation of hate speech. As such, he is one of the preferred targets of attacks by the far right and neo-Nazi movements in Portugal. In the beginning of 2020, Mamadou Ba received a letter with a death threat and one bullet case at his home. In February 2021, an online petition was launched to strip him from his Portuguese citizenship and to deport him from Portugal. And since June, the headquarters of the SOS Racismo movement were vandalised twice with swastikas and racist slurs. In the face of this hate and intimidation, Mamadou stands firm and continues his public work defending the rights of racial minorities in Portugal and across the continent. Congratulations, Mamadou.
O antirracismo é um ato de amor à humanidade. Qualquer ato antirracista é um ato de amor à humanidade. Da forma como eu amo meus filhos, é dessa forma que eu amo todos os outros filhos negros e as filhas negras, ciganas, imigrantes, e então essa é a razão pela qual também estou em luta, né? Não é só por uma questão de princípio, mas é também uma questão mesmo de necessidade biológica.
Que normalmente quando olhamos para lideranças de movimentos sociais, temos pessoas que são muito corajosas, temos pessoas que são muito inteligentes, temos pessoas que são muito capazes de negociação, mas raramente temos pessoas com essas características todas ao mesmo tempo. E o Mamadou tem isso, porque tem uma coragem que é uma coragem, inclusive, física, não é? De ser exposto a situações perigosas, junto com uma capacidade intelectual. Ele é um scholar em algumas coisas, não é? Pensa, estuda, reflete sobre o assunto e depois a capacidade de intervenção política, articulando com diferentes esferas do político e do movimento social. E isso é uma capacidade rara.
O Mamadou Ba, para além de ser um ativista antirracista, é ele próprio uma pessoa racializada. E também imigrante, né? E ele é muitas vezes usado, a própria imagem dele é usada como uma espécie de representação, não é, do negro que não sabe que não sabe ser agradecido pelo acolhimento que Portugal lhe deu. E os ataques racistas contra o Mamadou Ba, os insultos contra o seu ativismo, na maior parte das vezes têm um cunho racista. Não é só que as pessoas estão contra ou que acham que não há racismo em Portugal. É ser uma pessoa negra a fazê-lo. Ter a audácia de ser uma ingrata, não é? E de, na sua cabeça, claro, e de não ser um bom imigrante, um bom negro, não é? Que obedeça e que saiba estar agradecido, não é? Pelo lugar secundário que ele ainda tem na sociedade portuguesa, não é isso?
Se há uma coisa que uma pessoa negra no mundo branco sabe, é que o seu corpo é o seu país. Então, acho que sempre que alguém me diz que eu sou responsável pelo crescimento do racismo, porque eu ou sou responsável pelo racismo reverso, eu vejo isso como uma manobra de distração para não enfrentar o racismo. Eu costumo dizer que pessoas brancas podem ser antirracistas por princípio. Eu sou antirracista por convicção e por condição. Há uma convicção política que me obriga a ser antirracista, mas antes disso há uma condição biológica que me obriga a ser antirracista. Eu não tenho alternativa. Numa sociedade racista, uma pessoa racializada tem que ser antirracista. Porque, como eu disse no início, não é? O que me move é o amor à humanidade. É o amor, né? O amor, porque é impossível viver sem amor, né? Senão isto é sufocar. Eu não quero estar a viver num sufoco permanente, né? O racismo é um sufoco permanente.
Não é nosso.
Somos nós que pagamos.
Do nosso dinheiro.
Somos nós que pagamos.
É como estrangeiro. Como estrangeiro.
É que eu te pago. Pago 200 mil euros.
Pois.
Os ataques a ativistas como o Mamadou Ba, mas também outros, são de diferentes formatos ao mesmo tempo. Desde o insulto mais direto nas redes sociais, com uma perseguição constante com ameaças de violência física, com o insulto sistemático, não é? E a destruição da imagem pública destas pessoas.
Dizer isto que tu tens que ouvir, porque o ódio racial é promovido por vocês e por essa associação. Certo? O ódio racial é vocês promovem e depois fazem estas histórias todas.
E portanto, os ataques são aqueles mais crus. São os ataques de perseguição na rua, ameaças a ele e à família, aquilo que em Portugal se chamam as esperas, que é um grupo atacante estar à espera da pessoa à saída de um evento público e manifestar-se contra ela. Todos esses ataques são terríveis. Mas depois esses ataques tornam-se, têm uma câmara de ressonância nas redes sociais, onde são interpretados com linguagem de ódio. As mais terríveis acusações para mim são as que têm o efeito de boicotar o movimento antirracista e é a acusação de que, ao falar de racismo, está a promover o racismo.
Como não existem muitas instituições com capacidade para proteger um ativista com este tipo de questão, com este tipo de desafio, significa que muitas vezes corre-se o risco de se viver estas situações de forma muito sozinha, muito, muito isolada, não é? E isso é preocupante do ponto de vista económico, do ponto de vista pessoal, do ponto de vista político, para o movimento e para a pessoa. Com custas para advogados, com uma exposição pública também arriscada, e é um processo particularmente desgastante e destruidor das condições de vida destes ativistas, não é?
Fascismo nunca mais! Não passará! Fascismo nunca mais! Não passará!
O discurso que o Mamadou tem na sua ação é um discurso muito direto, diretamente sem rodeios e numa abordagem eventualmente naquilo que se chama politicamente incorreta.
Ele pensa sempre as questões do racismo, não esquecendo as questões de classe e, aliás, criticando aqueles que reduzem o racismo a questões de classe, e é muito vocal e muito aberto em relação às questões feministas e LGBT. e, portanto, tem uma noção muito grande dessa interseccionalidade.
O Mamadou foi uma voz que veio e permaneceu. Veio ali, para mim, logo ali, inícios de 2000, quando comecei a ver muito, quando começaram a aparecer muitos casos também, não sei se de uma forma também muito promocional, a televisão começou a virar-se muito para tudo o que acontecia, desde o Casal Ventoso à Cova da Moura, Margem Sul. Ele fez com que a Associação SOS Racismo se transformasse num movimento.
Eu sou alvo de ameaças desde 2012, ameaças diretas, que me chegam ao telefone, ou que me chegam ao mail, ou que me chegam por correio, desde 2012. Nunca, quase nunca, o Estado levou a sério as ameaças. Mesmo quando eu pedi proteção policial, eu tive proteção policial, é verdade, mas o Estado demorou muito tempo a me dar proteção policial. Eu fui alvo de duas emboscadas na rua. Eu podia ter morrido na rua. Podia ter morrido naquele dia, na rua. Não morri por sorte. E isto não se fala aqui na Europa.
Este prémio é também importante porque ele permite o reconhecimento, ou contribui para o reconhecimento, de que o racismo não é uma questão menor. Não é? O racismo está no centro do debate sobre que tipo de democracia é que nós queremos. E, portanto, não é possível haver democracia com desigualdade de género, não é possível haver democracia com desigualdade de classe, não é possível haver democracia com desigualdade entre pessoas com orientações sexuais distintas. E nós também temos que conseguir coletivamente perceber que não é possível haver democracia com racismo.
Gosto muito de entender os prémios que se ganham na luta como sendo processos coletivos. E o que eu espero que este prémio sirva é que, primeiro, que se perceba que nós não estamos isolados, não estamos sozinhos. Não é? O que fazemos tem impacto, tem eco, e é importante, então, continuar a fazer as coisas. Acreditar no que estamos a fazer e continuar a fazer, e continuar a estar mobilizado. Segundo, também isso aumenta a responsabilidade do Estado português. Porque o que este prémio diz é que há uma falácia na Europa que é preciso desmontar, que defensores de direitos humanos na Europa são tão ameaçados como defensores de direitos humanos em qualquer parte do mundo. E há a necessidade de alterar as condições de proteção dos defensores de direitos humanos na Europa ou no Ocidente.
Dear Mamadou, I would like to congratulate you on this award on my behalf, on behalf of all my colleagues at Frontline Defenders. This award celebrates not only your human rights work, but also, and maybe especially, your courage and your dedication. And your example shows us how sometimes it's very important to be very vocal and very visible for being heard, even though this visibility comes at a very high price. And hope this award would help to support and to amplify your voice, because as you say it very well, the anti-racism is not a political question, it's a question of humanity. And your work and the work of your colleagues help us, all of us, to become a little bit more human.
Hello, my name is Cormac Devlin, member of the Irish Parliament, and I'm honoured to present Alek Grabalewski and Sergei Dradewski as Europe and Central Asia winners of the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award. Sergei is the director of the Office for the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, while Alek is a lawyer with the organisation. The organisation was established in 2010 to advocate for the rights of persons with disabilities in Belarus and to work on policy change on accessibility issues. Campaigning to change government policies and public attitudes, the two human rights defenders have achieved major successes, including more than a dozen court cases defending and advocating the rights of persons with disabilities. The two were arrested as they extended their professional and legal skills to support protesters who had been arrested during popular demonstrations against election fraud in presidential elections.
пришел я, вообще говоря, в правозащиту, наверное, на рубеже 2000 года, когда, четко осознав, что моя инвалидность уже навсегда, я понял, что надо с этим что-то делать, и оказалось, что большинство проблем, которые мне надо было решать, проще решать не мне одному, а всем вместе. Мы с коллегами, создав такую организацию в 2010 году, в общем-то, развернули самое главное наше направление было то, чтобы страна, Беларусь, приняла на себя обязательства по Конвенции о правах людей с инвалидностью, с тем, чтобы, в общем-то, у нас появилась базовая основа для защиты наших прав, так как...
У той год, когда Сергей Дроздовский засновал правооборонную организацию «Офис по правах людей с инвалидностью», я отримал махчимость больш системно, професійна займацца абаронай правоў менавіта людзей з інваліднасцю. І па нейкім часе я стаў юрыстам гэтай арганізацыі. На той момант офіс па правах людзей з інваліднасцю ўжо дамогся таго, каб Беларусь ратыфікавала канвенцыю о правах людей с инвалидностью. И я пришел уже на такую глебу, когда я мог спокойно каждому человеку, который звертается в офис за оборону своих прав, сказать, что вы змагаетесь не только за... Вы змагаетесь не за льготы, вы змагаетесь не за милость, якую дает вам держава, вы змагаетесь за правы человека, вы змагаетесь за себе, как за особу. Вы можете апеллировать до нормы конвенции.
Белорусское право и белорусское государство все еще находятся в таком постсоветском режиме, патриархальном, где... к людям с инвалидностью относятся скорее с жалостью и с участием, нежели понимая их права, и нежели... Поэтому для нас это было очень важно, вообще говоря, менять и общественное сознание, потому что сказать лишь только власти виноваты тоже невозможно, потому что все общество привыкло жалеть, все общество привыкло относиться к людям с инвалидностью, как скажем, к меньшим братьям. С этим, в общем-то, шли к людям, мы делали исследования, мы проводили школы, мы проводили лекции, мы разговаривали со студентами, мы разговаривали с милиционерами, мы разговаривали со всеми. У нас нет и не было запрещенных тем. Так оказалось, что многие темы в Беларуси, ну, скажем так, оставались, были неудобными. Люди с психическими нарушениями, люди, лишенные дееспособности, люди, живущие в местах лишения свободы с инвалидностью и так далее, и так далее. То есть много тем, которые были неудобными, которые до нас, в общем-то, никто так не открывал.
Справа в том, что деятельность офиса по правах людей с инвалидностью, она была в определенной ступени, навод, можно так, не побоюсь этого слова сказать, уникальной, бо у нас в Беларуси амаль что нема организаций, которые профессионально занимаются отстоянием прав человека и помогают людям с инвалидностью в отстоянии их прав в таким достаточно широким сенсе в контексте всего каталога прав человека.
Для нас очень важно было именно то, что коллеги из Офиса по правам людей с инвалидностью, Сергей, Олег, другие, очень прониклись, очень хорошо понимают вот смысл недискриминации не только в отношении той группы, которой они непосредственно занимаются, но дискриминации как проблемы в принципе для прав человека, которая в принципе уничтожает достоинство и права человека в этом смысле как таковые.
Офис ожидаемлял системную працу, якая принесла свой плен, такие самые яркие, это как принятие конвенции, а потом поступово, покроково ажыццяўлялася имплементация норм конвенции у национальное законодательство. Гэтая сітуацыя, мяне ўсцешвала і падавалася, што так будзе заўсёды.
И да, начиная с событий 2020 года, августа 2020 года, мы активно включились в правозащитную коалицию. Мы пытались и старались всеми силами оказывать содействие всем, вне зависимости от того, есть у него удостоверение инвалида или нет удостоверения инвалида, по виду он с инвалидностью или нет. Если к нам человек обращался, мы помогали всем, потому что понимали, что находимся в зоне бедствия.
І першы ціск, які пачаўся на офіс, ён быў звязаны менавіта з тым, што офіс адкрыта заяўляў праз сродкі масавай інфармацыі, праз кааліцыі з грамадскімі арганізацыямі, праз аналітычныя матэрыялы, праз судовыя паседжанні, праз скаргі аб недапушчальнасці і катастрафічнасці гэтай сітуацыі. І у тыя дні, пачынаючы ад жніўня, і па той дзень, калі мы атрымалі статус абвінавачваных па крымінальнай справе, мы атрымлівалі звароты грамадзян, якія пацярпелі ад жорсткіх, бесчалавечных дзеянняў, непрапарцыянальных, як гэта кажацца ў міжнародным праве, дзеянняў супрацоўнікаў сілавых структур. Гэта былі людзі з траўмамі, там, ажога з траўмамі, якія жахлівыя ў звычайным жыцці, асколачныя гэтыя раненні, апёкі, збіццё. Намагаліся, каб ніхто, ніводны чалавек не сышоў без прававой дапамогі.
І, собственно, этим мы практически занимались почти все свое время, вот, всю осень. И так случилось, что 21 января к нам пришли с обыском, к нам пришли финансовая милиция с надуманными обвинениями, которые совершенно, даже в тот же день они были уже сняты.
У офис и одночасово домой до Сергея пришли люди у цивильным. Якія ў офісе былі, Сергея правязлі ў офіс, у яго прысутнасці, у маёй прысутнасці адбыўся ператрус, забралі ўсю дакументацыю, архтэхніку, зрабілі ўсё, каб паралізаваць нашу працу як арганізацыі.
По большому счёту, но есть не то желание, скажем так, расправиться с нашей организацией, как, в общем-то, с другими правозащитниками. И да, 3 февраля мы оказались под арестом.
Калі казаць пра сітуацыю ў Беларусі, сапраўды на сённяшні дзень дастаткова жахлівая, бо 3 сектар НЖО, праваабарончыя арганізацыі, яны наўпрост вынішчаюцца і застаецца проста выпаленае поле на сённяшні дзень.
То, што белорусское правозащитное сообщество, известно, сейчас находится в сложной ситуации, потому что кризис прав человека в стране, и одним из фокусов этого кризиса, конечно, стали сами правозащитники.
Когда мы кажем про офис людей с инвалидностью, то как раз таки это организация, которая вельми профессионально помогала отстоивать права человека. Больше за то, мне подается, что тут было бы правильно сказать об тем, вот такую тезу, что эта организация помогала не только отстоивать права и свободы человека, але еще и помогала вяртаць людзям пачуццё чалавечай годнасці. Чалавечая годнасць — гэта аснова в канцэпцыі правоў чалавека, бо гэта якраз такі з'яўляецца такім падмуркам у разуменні правоў чалавека і тое, пра што мы кажам, што такое правы чалавека і свабоды. І вот вяртанне вот гэтай чалавечай годнасці, мне падаецца, гэта было адным з такіх вельмі важных момантаў, важных фактараў у працы гэтай арганізацыі.
Калегі попалі тоже в сложную сітуацыю, аказаліся самі пад уголовным преследаваннем. Это просто недопустимо, когда мало того, что правозащитников преследуют, таких еще преследуют за работу, которая делалась вместе с Организацией Объединенных Наций, с офисом в Минске, которая как бы, кажется, будет дополнительную защиту получать. Но вот с белорусским режимом это все несколько наоборот. Поэтому для нас, конечно, мы просто очень рады, что коллеги наконец-то на свободе, что они могут, что им теперь, ну, вот в этой ситуации уже не так угрожает не побоюсь сказать, ужасы белорусской пенитенциарной системы.
Поэтому уже через полгода в августе выйдем, мы поняли, какая была огромная волна поддержки нас, какая была огромная волна поддержки правозащитного сообщества. И для нас это, конечно, такая вдохновляющая такая вещь, которая ценная сама по себе. То, что есть правозащитники, для которых нет границ, для которых нет там цвета кожи, нет возраста, нет пола. Есть только самая главная ценность — права человека, которые... ради которой все готовы работать и защищать друг друга. И для нас это было большим и важным, и остается, в общем-то, наверное, таким двигателем.
Зразумела, что я, и Сергей Дроздовский, мы люди, которые все свое житё, асэнсаванное профессийное житё, особисто у меня это 23 годы, мы просвятили правам человека. И мы не будем спынять эту працу, будем меняться только ее формат.
Ну, несмотря на то, что нашу организацию закрыли, мы все равно будем продолжать свою деятельность. Вне зависимости от того, где мы окажемся, в каком месте, в какой точке мира, неважно, для нас Беларусь остается нашей родиной, ее судьба для нас остается крайне единственной важной целью, которую мы хотим для себя ставить. И мы, в принципе, сегодня видим возможность для того, чтобы наши силы приложить к тому, чтобы каким-то образом вернуть, отстоять права людей с инвалидностью в этой тяжелой ситуации, как есть. Ну и, конечно, думать о будущем.
I'm Gary Gannon, Irish parliamentarian, and it's my great honor to introduce the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award winners for the Middle East and North Africa, Sami and Samia Hirani, co-founders of the grassroots movement Youth of Samud, based in the Al Tawani village in the South Hebron Hills in Palestine. The South Hebron Hills region is one of the most dangerous areas for Palestinians in the West Bank, with some of the most extremist Israeli settlements located in the area. Sami and Samia, Youth of Samud escort shepherds and school children under the threat of attacks by Israeli settlers and soldiers. Samia also organizes activities for women in her village. As a leader in the community, Sami is frequently harassed by Israeli settlers and the Israeli military for his peaceful work. He was arrested after participation in a peaceful demonstration on the 8th of January 2021. The demonstration was organized to protest against Israeli army violence, particularly after the shooting of the Palestinian activist Harun Abu Haram on the 4th of January, who was shot in the neck at point-blank range. Sami's trial is still ongoing. Congratulations to you, Sami and Samia.
أنا اسمي سامي الهريني من قرية لتواني مسافة رياض جنوب الخليل فلسطين المحتلة. بدي أحكي أنا عمري 24 سنة. أنا تجربتي في المقاومة الشعبية منذ الصغر.
أنا سميحة الهريني 22 سنة طالبة جامعة ناشطة شبابية في مجموعة شباب صمود في قرية تواني في منطقة جنوب الخليل. كانت الفكرة من بدايتها هي إنه كيف ندافع عن حقوق الإنسان في منطقة مسافرية الطاف في جنوب الخليل.
مجموعتنا انطلقت في 2017 من هاي القرية اللي هي قرية صرورة المهجرة اللي هجرها الاحتلال ومستوطني الاحتلال في نهاية التسعينات.
بالبداية كانت عبارة عن مخيم انقام في قرية صرورة بمسافة ريطة اللي هاي القرية بتيجي بين مستوطنتين، وكان في مخطط استيطاني لهذا القرية بالتهجير والسيطرة التامة عليها من أجل دمج هذول المستوطنتين في بعض والسيطرة أكثر على الأراضي الفلسطينية في المنطقة. بعد هيك شوي شوي بلشت الحركة تخف في المخيم، قررنا إحنا مجموعة شباب صبايا إنه نقود مختلف النشاطات اللي كانوا يقوموا فيها بهذا المخيم لتكملة الفكرة وإنه نكمل هاي الفكرة للأخير بعد ما جبنا هذا جذب الانتباه من قبل المستوطنين والاحتلال، لأنه زادت رغبتهم بالسيطرة عليها بأسرع وقت.
نعمرها من خلال نشاطات احنا بنرتبها يوميا، تم رميم الكهوف، زراعه الارض، بناء السلاسل الحجريه، تمديد المياه، يعني بصراحه اعاده الحياه بكل تفاصيلها لهي القريه. ايضا مرافقتنا لطلاب المدارس اللي بتعرضوا لاعتداءات المستوطنين من خلال مرورهم من خلال البؤر الاستيطانيه اللي بتعرضوا لاعتداءات المستوطنين. ايضا هو العنف اللي بتعرضوا له ليس فقط عنف جسدي وايضا عنف نفسي بسبب الاعتداءات وسبب الخوف اليومي اللي بمر فيه الطلاب خلال عبورهم هاي البؤر الاستيطانية.
أنا دوري الرئيسي بمجموعة صمود هي دعم وتطوير دور المرأة في الميدان. اشتغلت بكثير أمور تتعلق في تطوير مهارات المرأة من خلال مختلف مشاريع وأفكار هدفها بشكل أساسي هي دعم استمرارية نشاطات المرأة في الميدان في منطقة مسافر يطا. قمت على سبيل المثال في مشروع اسمه فوتو فويس، بيهدف أن النساء تحكي قصصهن عن طريق صورة بتقوم الست بالتقاطها في مكان بتحس أنه ممكن يعبر عن شخصيتها، ومن خلال صورتها تحكي قصة هي ممكن ما عندها هاي الجرأة إنها تحكيها بشكل مباشر في القصة.
بخصوص قرية صواني ومسافر يطا، هي منطقة مستهدفة من قبل الاحتلال منذ الاحتلال في 67 لغاية هذا اليوم. خلال سياسة الاحتلال تم تقسيم هاي المنطقة إلى قسمين، قسم تم إعلانه منطقة إطلاق نار اللي أعطوه رقم 918، والقسم الآخر تم استهداف مصادرة الأراضي وبناء المستوطنات. فبلش النشاط الاستيطاني في المنطقة في بداية الثمانينات، وبلشت معاناة الفلسطينيين في هاي المنطقة. فمصادرة الأراضي بتعني يعني حرمان الفلسطينيين من ممارسة حقهم الطبيعي على الأرض في الفلاحة وفي رعي أغنامهم، لأنه هاي المنطقة بشكل عام سكان هاي المنطقة بشكل عام هم فلاحين بسطاء بيعتمدوا أساسا على فلاحة الأرض وتربية المواشي. فبلش تضييق على الفلسطينيين في هاي المنطقة، وتحديدا كان التركيز على قرية صواني كونها هي التجمع الأكثر ترتيب بمعنى وجود مباني. فكان الهدف اللي هو بشكل يعني هدف الاحتلال بشكل أساسي اللي هو إخلاء هاي المنطقة من الفلسطينيين.
في قرية صرورة اللي قررنا انه نكمل مختلف نشاطاتنا فيها، هي عبارة عن كهوف كانوا يسكنوها الفلسطينيين يعني قبل ما نيجي احنا، ولما تهجروا منها لما هجروا من الاحتلال الاسرائيلي منها كانوا عايشين في كهوف. لما فتنا في القرية في 2017 كانت هاي الكهوف شبه مدمرة، يعني ما فيها اي مجال انه مش غير قابل انه الناس يعيشوا فيها. يعني هسا احنا عايشين في منطقة سي تحت السيطرة الاسرائيلية كاملة، ممنوع البناء، ممنوع اي بناء جديد يتم في المنطقه لانه بيعزز صمود الناس في المنطقه. فبلشنا بترميم الكهوف، ما كان سهل الموضوع زي ما تصورنا انها كهوف، كان كثير صعب الشغل لانه احنا كمان ممنوع نفوت اي ادوات تساعدنا، ادوات كهرباء، اي ادوات متطوره حديثه في موضوعيه ترميم الكهوف. حتى تخفف من عبء الشغل على الشباب اللي كانوا موجودين والمتطوعين. فكان كله تحت يعني ضغط وخوف وفي أي لحظة يتم مداهمة المكان واعتقال المتطوعين أو مصادرة الأدوات. فأربع سنين من المحاولات، أربع سنين من خلال الترميم.
أنا شخصياً تعرضت لعدة اعتداءات من قبل قطاع المستوطنين، اللي هي كانت أول اعتداء أدى إلى بتر يعني كسر ساقي بالكامل من خلال القيام المستوطنين بدهسي بآلة اسمها تركترون اللي هو كواد بالإنجليزي. قام المستوطنين ايضا يعني اضع اعتداء على شخصي باعتداء على المكان، حرق اشجار الزيتون والمحاصيل الموجوده في صاروره، اقتحام صاروره واشعال النيران داخل هذا الكهف بكافه محتوياته، كان يعني موجود مولد كهربائي والفرشات والعديد من الممتلكات الخاصه موجوده داخل الكهف، تم حرقها بالكامل بالكهف. كنت مسجونا لمدة أسبوع ومروري بالعديد من المحاكم خلال هذا الأسبوع داخل السجن.
سامي كذلك الأمر، يعني اعتقلوا يمكن أربع مرات كمان ولا أكثر. يجي حجوا علي على الدار حملوه في الليل على الساعة 1:30 الليل، والولاد كلهم نايمين الصغار. يعني شو شعور الأم يعني لما يجوا يحملوا ابنها من بين ايديها، وهم اقول لهم شو سوى سامي؟ شوف سامي من دون اي غوش، بدناش حدا يعرف انه يعني بدناش حدا يعرف انه خشوا على البيت على الساعه 1 في الليل.
تم الافراج عني بكفالات ماليه باهظه، وبعدها ايضا افراج عني وتوقيفي كل يوم جمعه، وذلك لمنعي من المشاركات في المظاهرات التي تقام كل يوم جمعه. وأيضاً
اللي خلاني أنضم لشباب صمود أو أكون يعني جزء من هاي الشباب، خلاني إنه أنا شفت يعني أشياء خلتني حببتني في هاي القضية إنه أنا أفوت بهيك إشي. حبهم للأرض، مساعدتهم للأطفال إنهم يودوهم على المدارس ويجيبوهم من المدارس خوفاً من أي خطر يجي عليهم. أنا مبسوطة لأني قدرت أساعد شعبي وشباب صمود في مسيرتهم ضد الاحتلال.
أنا وجود الشباب اللي مأمنين بالفكر، فكر المقاومة، فكر الدفاع عن حقوقنا واستمرار المقاومة هو صمام الأمان لاستمرارية الدفاع عن حقوقنا. فتم تأسيس شباب صمود. شباب صمود هم مجموعة من الشباب اللي يعني نقدر نقول الرائعين، اللي عندهم رؤية لاستمرارية المقاومة الشعبية واستمرارية النضال والدفاع عن الحقوق.
أنا بصراحة اللي شجعني وقادني إلى هاي الأكتيفيزم والنشاطات دعم جدتي إلي كونها امرأة فلسطينية وتعتبر الأيقونة في مسافة أيقونة المقاومة الشعبية، كون إلها تاريخها النضالي الطويل بعد ما تم تهجيرها بمنطقة 48 من قرية اسمها القريتين، صمدت وواجهت ظلم الاحتلال الإسرائيلي المستوطنين في منطقة مسافة فريطة. كانت هي المحفز الأساسي والكبير إلي في موضوعية نشاطاتي، وكوني أنا سميحة اليوم وكوني أنا متطوعة في مجموعة شباب صمود وكوني ناشطة شبابية بتطمح لخلق تغيير في المنطقة.
إحنا عارفين إنه الاحتلال لا بده يطلع شجرة، الاحتلال سواء الجيش أو المستوطنين إحنا راح نزرع مية. محاولة الهدم وتهجيرنا من أراضينا، إحنا متمسكين ومباشرة في اليوم الثاني بنبلش هدم. إحنا الاحتلال بحرمنا من أبسط حقوقنا، حقوقنا بالعيش بحرية وبكرامة على أرضنا.
زرعت أكثر شجر تدل على الحياة الفلسطينية، أنا بلشت ترجع لهذا المكان، وهذا جد فخر كثير إن لشباب صمود إن وصلنا هاي المرحلة.
من حقي إني أعيش بكرامة، من حقي إني أعيش بحرية، من حق ان اولادنا واطفالنا يروحوا على المدرسه بامان، حقنا ان نبني بيت نسكن فيه ونبني عيلتنا فيه. هاي حقوقنا الاساسيه والطبيعيه اللي هي الاحتلال بيحرمنا منها كل يوم.
Congratulations Sami and Samiha and all the activists and youth of Sumud.
Frontline Defenders is proud to recognize your work and struggle in defense of the rights of Palestinians to all freedoms, to their land, and to fundamental dignity and liberty. Your efforts to mobilize the younger generation in your region are seen around the world and are inspirational beyond the borders of Palestine. This brings the 2021 Frontline Defenders Award ceremony to a close. We are grateful to the patrons of the award, to the donors and to the supporters of Frontline Defenders, and to you for watching, listening, and sharing. At Frontline Defenders, we understand that the security and protection of human rights defenders has an impact far beyond the personal safety of individuals. The work of human rights defenders is transformative for society, for communities, and for the planet. Now, more than ever, we all need to stand up, speak out, and take action. With these awards, we bring greater attention to key struggles for justice and hope to expand the solidarity network for these courageous and determined human rights defenders. Thank you for spending your time with these human rights defenders.